24. We've been talking about Noah and the whole reality of his spiritual representation of being in Christ and judgment on the earth through the cross and salvation by being in the ark and therefore raised up together with him. And I want to just deal with a couple of sort of smaller issues right now, but things that go over in people's minds and stuff like that. So in Matthew 24, let's see. Let's look in verse 36 first. And we'll read 36 through 39. Okay, Matthew 24. But of that day and hour knoweth no man, no, not the angels of heaven, but my Father only. But as the days of Noah were, so shall also the coming of the Son of Man be. For as in the days that were before the flood, they were eating and drinking and marrying and giving in marriage until the day that Noah entered into the ark, and knew not until the flood came and took them all away, so shall also the coming of the Son of Man be. All right. You hear a lot of comments on end-time events and prophecy and stuff like that, and there's just a whole lot of information out there on that. And people are making the reality of the end or the judgment or all of that, judgment coming, they're making it all based simply on a moment in time that seems rather random, of which we have no awareness of. And so maybe if you're some sort of mystic, you might be able to figure it all out, because it's more like you know, the Da Vinci Code or something like this, where you have to figure out a whole bunch of clues. It's sort of like God is wanting us to be like Sherlock Holmes and figure all this stuff out about the clues that really are random and different, and we're supposed to examine everything carefully. However, I want to just deal with a couple of scriptures here in Matthew 24. This one here that we just read says, but as in the days of Noah were, so shall also the coming of the Son of Man be. First of all, just that thought, that this is Jesus speaking here, and Jesus himself is connecting the events of Noah with this reality of Christ appearing and judgment on the earth and that sort of thing. And so we can draw from that there is a correlation and there is a shadow to be seen in the relationship to Noah, and particularly to these subjects of judgment and to the subject of the coming of the Son of Man, if you will. Do I need to stop, or are y'all getting this? Pop. All right. I think I'm a little louder now. Okay. I want you to also notice verse 38, for as in the days that were before the flood, they were eating and drinking, marrying and giving in marriage. I remember hearing some guy on TV saying, okay, now, he read this scripture and he says, this proves that we're in the end times. And he said, because there's more eating going on and drinking, there's more fast food places, and that all of that is proof. All of that's I heard this on national TV, and all of that is proof fast food places are the proof. You know, which by the way, has nothing to do with Jesus. It has nothing to do with coming into any clear understanding of what the judgment is about in relationship to the cross. It simply is a random time that we're supposed to figure out the clues by noticing that KFC is spreading all over, or McDonald's has reached around the world or something. But if you read that scripture, I mean, let's just read it again. For as in the days of the days that were before the flood, they were eating and drinking, marrying and giving in marriage until the day that Noah entered into the ark. He is saying in the scripture previous to this that nobody knows the time. And he's using this example of the fact that they were eating and marrying and doing all this kind of stuff. Folks, they've been eating and marrying and doing all that stuff for all time. There's never been a time, and it didn't say that there would be an increase of that, and that's how you would know. It's saying that you won't know. I mean, the context there is saying you won't know, and then it says that. It says that it's basically saying this. It's not saying fast food will increase. It's saying life will go on as normal, and you will think everything is just normal, and then that's what it's saying. So it has nothing to do with eating and drinking other than that's the normal thing that we do, and we will assume that one day is just like the next. And then notice that it says they were eating, drinking, marrying, giving in marriage until the day that Noah entered into the ark. That's the key right there. That's the key. And let me read from my notes here that I wrote. The real sign, the actual event that signaled the end, was the ark itself. Many are focused on disaster events that have nothing to do with Christ. During the times of Noah, people were eating and drinking and giving marriage, but going into the ark was the true spiritual sign that the end was come, and not signs of destruction. For example, when he entered into the ark and God shut the door, that's the time. Does that make sense? That's the time. That's the signal. That's it right there. Now it's going to start raining. But see, that is a picture of those who are in Christ, the ark representing Christ, and it says in 1 Peter that is a sign of baptism or being brought down into a judgment of our own, which we'll get into at some other date. There was a judgment that took place on all people in the world, but there was another kind of judgment I'll call it the baptism judgment, baptized into his death. That took place for those in the ark. Now, I don't want to say any more about it. I want to wait to get into that. But on the subject that we're talking about, the clear event, I mean, if you understood, let's just say that you were a non-innocent bystander in the time of Noah, because apparently you didn't have any innocent bystanders. They were either involved in building the ark, or they weren't, you know, they were standing by mocking. Okay. But if you're watching that and you go, okay, now this guy told us, this Noah guy, he told us that God was going to judge the world, the whole world, and there was going to be a flood, and this was going to be a boat that he's building here, and that, the end was going to come. And so you watching him on day one and day two, day three, and day 103, I mean, because it was 120 years in building, you know, day 117, you know, 117, you know, and all of a sudden the day comes, but and we'll get into that at a certain juncture, but God didn't tell Noah the day that it was going to happen. Isn't that interesting? Why? He told him everything else. He told him about the ark. He told him about the animals. He told him about all this stuff. But he didn't tell him the day that it was going to happen. Because the day would be dependent on the day that the ark is finished and you get inside of it. That's when this world ends and the new world begins. That's how you'll know. So he's watching him, and then let's just say that he's watching this whole thing, and then he's noticing, hey, them Noah boys are getting in that their boat. And hey, they're gathering in their wives and their kids too. And Noah's wife just went in, and the last one sitting there is Noah, and he's going in, and the door's getting shut. The ark is the sign, and the ark represents Christ, and Noah and his family represent those who enter into Christ and who are protected from the judgment because they are found in Christ, and they are not judged, but the ark goes through the storm, and it is judged, just like the people, but he rises above it. He's raised out of it, and we are raised with him, in him, not with him, in him. We were raised up and made to sit together in heavenly places in Christ Jesus. And that's what the scriptures say. So there is this incredible, you know, let's just say that this same bystander was looking, you know, and on day, you know, or not day, but year, 75 years into it, he notices that, you know, the wind picks up or there's an earthquake. And he goes, that's it. That's the sign right there. It's an earthquake. You know, or this thing happened over here. That's the sign. There was lightning hit a tree next to my house. That's the sign. No, you can sit there and watch that. And you can, let me tell you, you can watch world events till your eyes fall out on your carpet. And you're not going to know anything better than what you knew before you decided to start looking at that stuff until you look at the ark and until you look at the people that God is separating from the judgment and calling into that ark. You're not going to figure it out until you start seeing everybody getting in there. And then when they're in there and God says, that's it, and shuts the door, that's the sign. So let me just make sure I read. But going into the ark was the true spiritual sign that the end was come and not signs of destruction. Many are depending on certain outward signs to prepare them in advance so that they might be ready. And I mean, what readiness are we going to have if, you know, I'm just, you know, what readiness are you going to have? You know, it says of the people, they ran into the caves and they cried out, let the rocks fall on us. You know, they gnawed their tongues for pain and blasphemed God. You're not going to be ready. There is no ready. You know, well, I have 200 cans of soup and a lighter. You know, I got news for you. You know, that's not, it's kind of like the example I've given years, some of you know, years ago, it was some thought of, you know, if, and this was before the Iron Curtain fell and all that, you know, Russia, if they bombed certain places, one of the places they would bomb is Denton, Texas, because right out here on the south side of town is a special secret place that is one of the few NORAD places that you could protect the president and on and on and on. Pardon? East side. And so there is this, you know, I remember people saying, my God, then I don't want to live here in Denton because, you know, if World War III starts and they nuke, they're going to hit this place and we'll all be dead. Folks, if they started bombing the U.S. with nukes, I wouldn't want to be alive. I would want to be right where they hit me and sent me straight to Jesus. You know, I don't want to live in nuclear winter. I don't want to live with, you know, skin all, you know, and everybody's mutating and stuff like that. You know, that's not my idea. Thank God I got 200 cans of soup, you know. And I'll protect it from the mutants. I mean, come on. Now, I'm going to say this, and I'll be killed by them. Survivalists are idiots if you know. I mean, in the sense that you better trust in God. You better trust in the Lord. And you better have a plan that's bigger than 200 cans of soup. Or, yeah, 201, we'll do it. Yeah. Well, it's like that old Twilight Zone movie where the guy wanted to read, and he wore big, thick glasses, and he loved reading, and nobody let him read and everything. And so then all of a sudden, the end came, and everything was destroyed, and the guy had all of these books, and he was at the library, and his glasses fell and broke, and now he couldn't read anymore, and he's living, you know, eternity around books. But he, you know. Well, let's call it poetic justice. But let's call it faith in the living God when Noah and his family go up and get into that ark, and you say, you know what? That right there is the biggest sign I could ever receive that God's had it with us and he's taken his own in Christ unto himself. Okay? So let me make sure many are depending on certain outward signs to prepare them in advance so that they might be ready. But we are only able to have boldness in the day of judgment based on one thing. Boldness on the day of judgment. That one thing is not prophetic knowledge, nor is it lack of sins. Well, let's just read it. Keep your place here because I haven't read all the scriptures in Matthew, but let's read 1 John chapter 4 and see what it is that'll give us boldness in the day of judgment. Not just boldness, but boldness in the day of judgment. 1 John chapter 4. Verse 17. Herein is our love made perfect, that we may have boldness in the day of judgment, because as he is, so are we in this world. You see what it's saying? You want boldness in the day of judgment? Here's how you have boldness. It is boldness and confidence in that day that comes only by oneness, because as he is, that's the way we are. That we're one with him. As he is in heavenly places, that's how we are, even though we're in this world. Boldness in the day of judgment is not going to come by any outward thing. It's going to come by a deep spiritual reality of oneness with him. It's going to come by union, which is what Noah and his family had. They said, we are one with the Lord. And this ark representing the Lord, they are being found in Christ. What did Paul say? Being found in him, not having mine own righteousness, not which is by the law, meaning which is by works, meaning which is by individual effort, you know. But I don't know how many of you study the Greek. You look at the Greek, and if you go through the New Testament, there's just, you know, probably hundreds of times where the word power is used. Dunamis. But there's another word that's translated power too, and I don't know if I can pronounce it right, but it's exousia. And it is, and you know, one of the scriptures, what is it in John chapter 1 that says, well, let me see, I don't like trying to quote stuff that I'd do better off reading. But as many as received him, to them he gave the power to become the sons of God, even to them that believe on his name. This is something to those who received him. He gave power, but that word power is not he gave you the ability, because you don't have the ability to become a son of God. That'd be a work. That would be something you would do. You would produce it. You would be good enough. You would be holy enough. You would be better. But I got news for you. all have sinned and come short of the glory of God, and no one measures up. So that word power there couldn't possibly be dunamis. It couldn't possibly be relating to ability. It is relating to authority, giving you, God giving you the right to choose that I received him, now I want to be conformed to him. Now I want to be a son of God. Now I want to appear in the image of Christ. To all those who get saved, he gives you the right to choose that if you so want it. But to do that, doesn't make it happen. It's choosing and choosing and continuing. If you continue in my word, you shall know the truth. If you continue, Jesus said that. And matching this scripture right here, it says in John 8:31, Jesus, just before this scripture I'm about to quote, it says, and when he said that, many believed on his name. Many believers. You'd think that's what Jesus wants. I want many believers. I want believers to follow. I came here to get you to believe in me. Jesus turned, it says this, but Jesus turned to those who believed on him and said, if you believers continue in my word, continue, you will know the truth. But we believe. You believe in me, but you don't know the truth of it. You will know the truth, and the truth will make you free, not set you free, make you free. You'll be made into something. And so we see that there is this choice that Noah made. And his choice was faith, and you can read that over in Hebrews 11:7. His choice was faith. His choice was trust. His choice was not trust in himself. You know, anybody see Cool Hand Luke when he didn't believe in God and he's standing out in the rain and the thunder and everything? He says, if there's a God, you know, talk to me or do, you know, strike me dead or whatever. Nothing happens. He goes, well, that proves it. You know, we think we're going to stand on our own 2 feet out in front of God. Talk to me if you're real. Prove yourself. Folks, we need to prove ourselves. We need to prove our faith in him, not prove our ability. Not because no man by his own works can come to that stature. But you stand, you say, look, I trust you, and I'm not trying to get you to answer to this man standing out in this rain. I'm getting in you. I'm being found in you. I'm losing my first birth identity, and I'm gaining my new birth identity. I'm changing all that my parents knew about me. I'm changing all that my friends, my BC days friends, knew about me. I'm changing from my first birth identity to my new birth identity. I'm being found in him. Not having anything that I offer of myself other than my faith in you, therefore my faith causes me to get inside of you, to be found in you, the same that Noah did, being found in that ark. And he said, my protection is not me standing out. You know, I mean, that's what we do. We stand out in the rain and we say, okay, the rain started. Lord, you know, here's modern day Christianity. Lord, put a bubble around me, right? Put an invisible bubble, and then it goes, and then the rain is all, and we're just going, and everybody's drowning, you know. And we're going, hey, I have the God of miracles, you know. I mean, that's sort of our attitude, you know. Folks, we may have a God of miracles, and I believe in miracles, but I believe in Jesus as the God of miracles. I don't just believe in miracles. And folks, there will come a day when he will not give you a miracle. Then what are you going to do? Then what are you going to do? Where are you? You know? Where are you? Well, he'd say, I'm over here. I'm this ark. You know? Well, can you just reach your ark hand over here? And no. Then how are you going to save me? I'm going to save you by you leaving your place in this world and coming into me, and me becoming your place, me becoming your habitation, me becoming your strong tower, me becoming your rest, me becoming your home. That's not just a change of location. It's a change of identity. Because if you change your doctrines and your doctrines don't change your identity, then you've got nothing. You must be so identified with Christ. And that's why it says, "Beloved, behold what manner of love that he hath bestowed upon us that we should be called the sons of God." That's a change of identity. I mean, whoever you were born in, whatever little town you were born in, you weren't a son of God. You were a, shall I say it, son of Sam. I mean, son of Satan. You know? You were an enemy of God. And there was nothing, you know, there was nothing special about you that God said, you know, you're going to be saved because you're special. Folks, it's whosoever will that chooses him and that trusts in him, not because you're special. And I saw a show the other day where I was talking, and this person had a child, and they said, "You have a beautiful child." And she said, "Yes, she's special." And the guy said to her, "You know, all parents say that about their kid. That kid's special." He said, what happened when they turn adults? None of them are special. You know, if the world's full of all that many special people, kids, why isn't the world full of them? You know? Well, we want to believe it's about us being special when I say it's about Christ. And it's about him being special. And it's about us being offered. He's given us the authority, the right to step inside, as it were, and you know I'm using that, but step inside the ark and be found in him. And what did Jesus, or what did Isaiah say? The strokes, the beating that should have fallen on you has fallen upon me. The storm that should have wiped you away with everyone else, because all have sinned. You know, what does all mean? All, that's good. Good, that's right. Because it means all, you know. There's nobody left out. All have sinned and come short. So all should be wiped out. But we are in him, not standing on our own merits, not believing in ourselves. You know, that's a, you know, some people say, "You teach a terrible gospel. You're tearing people down." No, I'm explaining to them that they're already tore down. But Jesus still offers himself, not just salvation, but himself. Because could not God just have done a miracle for that group? But as it were, now this is a shadow. He came down to the earth in the form of an ark, as it were. A vehicle that would take us through the storm, bring us up in resurrection, and bring us into a new creation. That's undeserved. That is, I mean, the very scripture that we read in the first class, Noah found grace in the eyes of the Lord. Oh, man. And then he found an ark in the heart of the Lord. As the Lord began to explain his heart, he found there's an ark in his heart. There's an ark. There is a method through judgment, but it's not just getting you through judgment, it's bringing you into something new. You know, I mean, that's two different things, folks. I mean, judging the old and bringing you into something new, judging your sins and calling you a son of God, those are two different things. You know, you were a sinner Now you're a sinner saved by grace. Well, that's one view, but the other one is, beloved, now are we the sons of God. We are the offspring of God. We have the seed of God within us, Christ. Well, there's no merit for that either. Because in our minds, all we want to do is escape the judgment. We just want to escape the flood. I just don't want to burn in hell forever. Or I just don't want to stand before God for all the stuff I've done wrong. Well, if you're in Christ, you're accepted in the ark. Not by the beloved. You know, that would be like the ark sitting over there and the rain start, and the ark has a little mountain and says, I accept you over there. You know, we know that won't happen, but I'm just trying to paint a picture that makes that kind of theology look stupid. I'm sorry, but it's not that it's stupid, but it makes it look stupid. Because the ark is not accepting people out there. We are accepted in union, in oneness with what? The beloved. If he's beloved and we're one with him, what are we? Beloved, it doth not yet appear what we shall be, but when we see him, we shall be like him. See, same word, beloved, beloved. But we're not beloved other than this true change of identity because a true change has come. Death to the old man. I am crucified with Christ, or the old nature. Resurrection, nevertheless I live, yet not I, Christ lives in me. And an understanding that the cross did more than just save us from what was bad, but he brought us into all that was in his heart and all that he would give his son. He says, you're in the son, all of this new creation is yours, and I look at you now as my son, because you were one with him. Now, that's not saying we're God or we're the son of God in the sense of little gods or none of that craziness. You know, it's saying he's God. It's saying he's the son of God and he lives within us and he's still God in us, but we're not God. I mean, if you were God, just fix a few things. I mean, everything's so messed up everywhere. Just fix a few things. Come on, God. You know? Well, let's take that a step further. Why isn't the Lord fixing everything? There you have it. You see, because he's not, you know, it's like when the God began to share with Noah his plan. He didn't say, you know, Noah could have come to God and said, now, Lord, I found grace in your eyes. So, see that hospital over there? Just go over and heal all them people. See this terrible situation over here? Just go fix that. All right. The concept is that God is a fixer of things. That's not what he is. He's a father. The biggest name God began to be called in the New Testament is Father, over and over and over. If you'd like to challenge that, go through the Gospel of John with a marker and mark every time the word Father is used, and you'll be shocked. Because Jesus didn't come to introduce us to God the fixer. He came to introduce us to the Father. And the only way that you can be introduced to the Father is to be of the same seed, the same DNA. And to be of the same DNA is for us to receive oneness with Christ. Oneness. So, God's method wasn't, okay, you know, Noah, this world's messed up, and I'm going to go right to work on fixing stuff. He said, no. There is no hope for anything outside of my son. Did you get that? There's no hope for resurrection. There's no hope for getting through the judgment. There's no hope for you. Well, we don't like to hear that. But there's no hope for you. And there's no hope for me unless Christ is made unto us that hope. He is our hope, the scriptures say. It doesn't say he gives us hope. It says he is our hope. And there, Jesus, yes, Lord, yes, you are the one. I love you. But what you have to do is you have to recognize that problem over there, he's not going to try to fix that first and foremost. That problem over there, he won't try to fix. Me, he's not going to try to fix first and foremost. What he wants is for me to say to him, if you will, I'm just, you know, Lord, I see that everything is messed up. The only perfect one is you. The only one that pleases the Father all the time, that's you. The only one who never sinned, well, that was you. The only one whose motives were completely pure in all that you did, that was you. Everybody else is messed up. And so, I mean, you either say, save all of us wrong-motivated, yucky people, so put us in heaven. Can you imagine that? Can you imagine him just saving us in our state? Okay, you're saved from hell, but you still, let me just say it like this, you're still imperfect. Let me say it like that. And I'm just going to put you in heaven. What do you think heaven's going to be like in a few years? Hell yeah. Yeah, that's right. Well, it will be exactly like what we're living in now, if you will. We'll mess everything up. I mean, look at man. Every time man touches something, it gets worse, you know. So there has to be a recognition in us that says, it's all messed up except you, Lord. And that recognition has to be so strong, so convincing, so powerful in our mind that it is branded within our being that I'm not it. I'm not the one. You know, they're looking for the Messiah and they come up to you like John the Baptist. Are you the one? I ain't the one. See, John was a smart man. See, I ain't the one. I'm not even worthy to undo his shoe latch. I'm not the one. I'm pointing everybody to the one. See? Well, if the Pharisees came to us and we were around there, oh, you think I might be the one? Yeah, I might be. Yeah. I just might be. How much you believe that? You know? I'm the Savior of the world, the one with all the answers. Everybody's going to be happy now that I'm set up. Oh, y'all think I'm talking about something else. No, I'm just talking about principle here. You know? If you want to go in political realms, that's your business. But I'm just saying. I'm just saying that we need to be convinced that we need Jesus. I mean, really convinced. I mean it. You say, why does the Lord, you know, the first 5 years of my life, everything was wonderful. Flowers were coming up everywhere. It was glorious. It was a beautiful walk with the Lord. I mean, there were miracles and there were blessings. And now it seems like God himself is my enemy. Anybody know what I'm talking about? You know? I mean, it feels like that. Why? Because, oh yeah, you prayed the prayer of salvation, but you don't really see yet how much you need him. He said, no, I do. That's enough. That's self-preservation talk. That's not a sincere heart. That's not humility. That's right. Just, you know, yes, Master, I'll do anything you want. No, you won't. You will, as soon as you start feeling better. I mean, you know, some of you have been, the Lord's got brought you down where you were finally humbled, right? You remember that, some of you? You were humble, oh, I just trust you, Lord, and everything. And then once he took away the circumstances that brought you to that place, oh, pride just starts going, I'm back. And you wondered in your mind, well, he dealt with me so deeply, I never thought I'd be back here again. You know? Well, as long as it's you, then you'll just keep going around another lap in the wilderness. 40 years. Going around one more time, you know, and saying, well, I know this, Lord. I know that cactus. I've seen it, you know, 30 times. I know this. He's going, you know the wilderness. You don't know the promised land. You know, you've got a master's in wilderness wandering. But you don't know anything about the promised land. And his heart is to bring us into the promised land. But he can't just bring wild, crazy people in there. And so, he's working on us and working on us, and he's doing things in order to get our eyes fixed on this reality. That you, this ark, is the only thing going to make it through, and I'm getting in you and getting in union with you. And from now on, I'm going to change my thinking. There's that movie again, that Cool Hand Luke. What the prison warden say to him? You need to change your thinking or something like that, you know. And, of course, Cool Hand Luke smiling at him. Yeah, yes, sir. Yeah. He's giving that, yeah, right. That's us. You ever wonder why you like that movie so much? We still got a little bit of pride. We're laying there dying with a little smile on our face. You know, we were talking about it at dinner. You know, I did it my way. You know, I'm going to write another song called I Did It Yahweh. All right, maybe I should read. It's disintegrating fast. All right, so it was the same day that became salvation for Noah that also became death for others. Now, that's important. It's the same day, because as it was in the days of Noah, folks, the judgment in the day of Noah, the same day the judgment was the same day of salvation. The same day. Do you understand what I'm saying? I'm emphasizing the same day. Whereas in our minds, we have it that there's going to be, we get saved now, but there's going to be a day of judgment. But he says, as it was in the day of Noah, there would be judgment and there would be salvation. There would be judgment upon all flesh, but there would be oneness for those found in him, all on the same day. What day is that? That's not some future judgment day. What day is that? Well, that's the day of the cross. Because that's where judgment was meted out. That's where all the flame and all the anger and all of the repercussions against sin was punished in the person of Jesus. Am I right or wrong? He bore all sins. Folks, if somebody gets saved today, Jesus doesn't have to go back, get on the cross, and die for their sins. Now, he already died for their sins, even though they're walking around not believing in the Lord. Well, what does that tell us? That tells us the issue then is not if he died for our sins, but do we believe in him? Do we believe in oneness? Because if he already died for the sins, then that's no longer an issue. What's the issue? What is our relationship to this ark? I believe in that ark over there. I believe in that ark. You know, I mean, it's some guy hanging out with Noah in the crowd walking around, you know. Yeah, I believe in that thing. Oh, yeah. I walk up every day and put my hands on it and go humma mama or something, you know. This ark, this is it, you know. And then the day comes and he doesn't get in it. because he believes in an object that's over there. Do you understand what I'm trying to communicate? I'm trying to communicate that you got to get in it. You got to, as it were, become one with it. You've got to change who you are. You've got to leave behind your old life, your old way, your old view. Because when you come into the new, boy, there's going to be an upheaval on this. You know, you understand, there's going to be an upheaval and you won't recognize things as you did before. Where's old Bob's house over? I don't think old Bob's house is going to be there. You know. It's going to be, everything is going to be changed. The high will be brought down, the low will be brought up, the crooked will be made straight. That's what John said of Jesus. Folks, that's the cross, the day the axe is laid to the root. But at the same day that he died, and it was the judgment of all flesh, is the same day that we became one with him. Now, I won't get into all that and try to explain that now, but there are plenty of other courses and classes where I get into him drinking the cup and what that meant and how that brought about a oneness with him. And I'll just say this. We had to be one with him before we went to the cross. Can I get amen? I mean, he's going to take us to the cross. Paul said, I am crucified with Christ. That meant you were one with him at the cross. Amen? Well, where did the oneness take place? I believe it took place in the Garden of Gethsemane when he drank the cup. Now, that's my opinion, and if you don't believe that, it's fine. I mean, and I'm also open to the Lord showing me something different. But I believe that that's where we became one with him, and then once we became one, the struggle is over. His job now is to take us to that cross and finish the work that he started. All right. So, the same God who released the flood on the world also shut Noah and his family in the ark. The same one who judged the world saved those who are in Son. That's what it means in Hebrews. Hebrews 1:1. Well, 1:1 through what, 3? That in times past he moved by prophets and this and that and that and that, but now he speaks in Son. The true hearing of God today is in ark. And if you don't hear the ark of God's heart, if you don't hear the ark of God's heart, remember that ark was in there long before God explained it to Noah and had him build it. The concept of all being in one and through that one being released was in there from before the foundation of the world. And you can read that in Ephesians. We'll bear that out. And so there is that understanding that comes to those who are already saved. That God's not just trying to say, get me through this flood. No, does that sound? Just think on a normal way how you relate to God. Do you think God's trying to get you through your flood? Or do you think God would be more interested in getting you to understand that he wants you in Christ and viewed from there and speaking from there, so that he can bring you into all fullness? That's the difference. When you're just self-centered, all you want to do is get out of anything that doesn't feel comfortable. Can I get amen? That's so us. That's human nature. We just want to get out of something that doesn't feel comfortable. All right, so, but the plan is not just salvation that offers acceptance, but for all things to be founded in Christ. Therefore, the rains would not come till the ark was complete. And then, however, that was only part of what needed to happen. The preparations involved a twofold work: finishing the ark and filling the ark. end wasn't going to come until that reality was full. Now, if you want to see that, we'll look in Ephesians real quick, and then we'll stop here shortly. Ephesians chapter 1. I told you it was in Ephesians 1. Okay, finishing the ark and filling the ark. Let me finish reading this sentence, two sentences here, and then we'll read the scripture. Jesus finished the work on the cross, but the rains did not come then. There was still a work needed that involves filling. All right, Ephesians 1 and verse 10. That in the dispensation of the fullness of times, he might gather together in one all things in Christ. See that? In union with Christ, both which are in heaven and which are on earth, even in him. Now look at verse 23 of that same chapter. Let's go to 22:23. And hath put all things under his feet and gave him to be the head over all things to the church, which is his body, the fullness of him that filleth all in all. There is a filling. He wants to fill us. And he wants to fill that ark. And for him, it's not just about having. It's about filling. Okay, let's go to chapter 3, verse we're going to verse 19, but let's start in 17. That Christ may dwell in your hearts by faith, that you, being rooted and grounded in love, may be able to comprehend with all saints what is the breadth and length and depth and height, and to know the love of Christ, which passeth knowledge, that you might be filled with all the fullness of God. All right, so it's talking about Christ dwelling in your heart, not just, you know, I mean, it's moving to this thing of that he might fill all things and that he might fill us. He comes into us not to be in some little compartment that we talk to Jesus in there, but that he fills us with his life. And then he says that you may be able to comprehend with all saints what is the breadth and length and depth and height. This is future. In the sense of, there are those who are saved, that Christ has saved them, and we'll get into this the very next class, but they have not entered into all of that. To them who received him, past tense, he gave the power to become the sons of God. Okay. So there's a progressive work of filling. It's like the ark is complete. Okay, well, let's fill it. And for you and me, there's a work of filling us with the fullness of Christ. What did John say? He must increase and I must decrease. There's a filling going on right there. Was John a man of God? Yeah, he's one of the few men of God on the planet when Jesus came, maybe the only. And that man of God described his comprehension of the relationship with God as this: he must increase, the one I'm talking about, this Jesus, he must increase and I need to decrease. More of Jesus, less of me. Me, Tarzan, you, Jane. I mean, you know, that's pretty simple language. It is simply about, and you know, if this cup is already filled, and I wanted, this got tea in it, and I wanted Coke, and it was already filled with tea, how am I going to fill this cup with what I really desire? You have to empty out what's the contents and fill it with the desired contents. Right? Well, how is the Lord going to, even if we're his vessels, even if we're saved from hell as a vessel, this vessel is not going to go to hell. How are we going to reach God's end if we continue to have our life increasing by, and you know, there are some denominations and whatever that preach Christianity that it is all about an increase of you. It's an increase of your finances. It's an increase of this. It's an increase of that. You get this. You get that. You win. You know, everything is yours. But John described the coming of Jesus, the coming of Jesus, and he said, this is what he's going to be like. I'm declaring. Remember, John was the only one who was God sent to declare what he was like. He says, there's one coming. And he said, now, my relationship with the one that's coming is, he must increase and I must decrease. Well, that's powerful. That's powerful. But you know what? It's really simple. It's not deep. John said, I'm a man of God, but I'm not it. When people want to make me something, I'm not it. And then he said, but there is one who is it. And his name is Jesus. And my life is involved in serving him by baptism. Remember, that's what Noah represents in the ark. But I'm serving him by, let's just say, I'm serving him by ministry to people. But what's in my deepest heart is not having a big ministry. What's in my deepest heart is that he must increase and I must decrease. In other words, if you talk to the man, that's what he would communicate. This is what I'm about. Well, what about this ministry you're doing? It's only an expression of a deeper desire that I have. I want all people to decrease and Christ to increase. That's what the ministry is. I mean, if you're listening to John, that's what he said. That's what my ministry is. But all of that comes out of one spring that springs from my core. Whatever I want for people, I want it more for me. I want more Jesus in my life. I want less of my flesh, less of my impatience, less of my critical spirit, less of my hard-headedness, less of me. So you begin to catch a glimpse of this reality, just a shadow. Remember, the ark and all of that's just a shadow. If you had a picture of something, or you had a shape of something, or you had the reality of a person standing there, and then you saw the shadow would give you a sort of outline of what it looks like, but you'd never know the person by looking at the shadow. Well, the ark is just a shadow. If the Spirit of God doesn't open our eyes to see Jesus, then we will just be talking about shadows. And I don't want to just talk about shadows. And I don't want to just say, oh, look at the deep knowledge about Noah and the ark. That's ridiculous. I want to know Jesus. I want him to increase. I want to decrease. And I'm dedicated to that. And if the ministry rises or falls, as long as I can draw one breath, I want more of Jesus. And I know that you feel the same way, but we have to say it. We have to declare it like that. All right, let's take a break, and we'll come back shortly.